Jesus.
And that is who you are.
Everybody got really quiet. Am I on? Can you hear me? Okay. Good morning. It was 8:58, and I thought we started at 9. My bad. So, good morning, everybody. It's so good to see you. So, I'm a hugger, and it has been a really difficult few Sundays for me because I just want to hug all your necks, and apparently I can't do that, they say. So, I've patted myself on the back because I have refrained, and so I'm so proud of myself. But anyway, I'm so glad to see you all this morning. Very quickly, I want to tell you about something that's going on next Sunday morning. At 10 o'clock, if you have a child from a rising first grader through a rising 12th grader, Zach and I would like to invite you to join us at 10 o'clock next Sunday morning, so in between services, for like a little snack, I don't know, donuts, something probably not healthy, so that we can kind of start to cast a vision for all of you of what is going to take place this summer. We are hoping to start kind of opening some things back up for the kids and the youth. I have loved working with Zach already over the past 2 weeks because we're just working together to kind of bring the family unit together as well. And so I'm super excited about some things that we have planned. Originally, Promotion Sunday was actually supposed to be today. So if you have a child, today was supposed to be the day they promoted to the next grade. We have pushed that to tentatively August 9th, depending on what the schools decide. So we would like to meet with you next Sunday just to kind of give you an idea of what we're thinking, maybe get your feedback, just kind of dialogue back and forth with all of you and what you're thinking as far as your child and your concerns and maybe what you would like to see happen. So if you please join us. For all of you who can't join us, just know that we love you still. All right, let me pray for us. Father, you are so amazing. And I am just thrilled to be here this morning. Every single morning that I get to join with my brothers and sisters makes my heart just so full of joy. But what I'm learning, Lord, over and over in the last 12 years of journeying with you is that it's in the secret place that you do such a work in me, so that when I come together with brothers and sisters, I can be an encouragement, or maybe they can encourage me, whatever it might be. And I just love that. And I pray that we do not take that for granted, that this morning, if we feel moved to go share a word with someone, or maybe if something Tim says resonates so deep with us and we're like, Father, take us deeper with that so that we can share it with someone else, we would do that. Lord, let it not just be out of obligation that we're here this morning, but because we long to just worship you corporately, to take in all that you have for us in this next 45 minutes to an hour, and that when we leave out here, we're recharged, we're refreshed, and we're ready to face the day. That does not mean that we're not still struggling with some stuff. That doesn't mean that maybe our hearts aren't heavy, because I know for a fact, with all that's going on in this world, some of us in here, our hearts are very heavy. We can't ignore what is happening, but what I do know is that our battle is not with flesh and blood. It's against the evilness in this world, the principalities, all the darkness that has come. But through Jesus, we have victory. Let us not forget that this morning, that we have victory in Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for that. Oh, I'm so thankful we get to worship this morning. Father, may you be glorified. May you be glorified in all that we say, think, and do in this time that we have together. We so love you. I love you. And we bless your name. Amen.
Let's all stand together. Oh God, our help in ages past. I love to just shout to the Lord in song.
because of what he's done for me. I'm so glad that my God, who has been with me all of my life, not just with me, but all of my ancestors, all those Christians before me, all those people back to Abraham, all those people, he has been there for them. No matter what they've gone through some really rough times, a lot rougher times than we're going through. But God has always been there. That same God is with us. He is with us. And that makes me want to sing. It does. That's what God has given me. He's given me not just the ability to sing and to play and all that stuff, but he's given me the passion to just cry out to him. And I hope that that's what you're feeling here this morning. That you take this time on Sunday mornings and say, I want to praise God. I know my life might not be great right now. I might not have a job. I don't know what I'm going to do. Somebody I know is really sick. I might be really sick. But God, the God who's been here forever, is still here. He's still on the throne. Scripture this morning from Psalm 59 says, but I will sing of your strength in the morning. I will sing of your love. For you are my fortress, my refuge in times of trouble. That's what he is. Not only in the past, not only right now, but he will be forever. This song is something that's come out in the last couple of years that I think is as truly a song for the church. This is, Is He Worthy? Do you feel the world is broken? How about that?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows steepen?
We do.
But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? That's right.
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made new?
We do.
Is all creation groaning?
It is.
Is a new creation coming?
It is.
Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst?
It is.
Is it good that we remind ourselves of this?
It
is. Is anyone worthy?
Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy?
Is he worthy
of all blessing and honor and glory?
Is he worthy of it? He is. Does the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And does Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves?
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us?
He does.
Is anyone worthy?
Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave.
From
blessing and honor and glory. He is worthy of it. He is.
Let's pray together. Father, thank you this morning that you're worthy. Jesus is worthy. We're not worthy. We're not worthless. You value us very much, but we are unworthy. And yet, you continue to bless, you continue to love, you continue to forgive, and you continue to guide. And so as we gather this morning, I pray that your worthiness would be in the midst of everything we're doing, that we would see your worthiness, your worth. And that's why we worship. It's what the word means. And so we come together today to worship you, to praise your name. And I thank you for everyone who's here, and I pray your blessing on everyone here, those who are watching at home. I just pray that you would reach into our hearts, touch us, draw us to yourself, be glorified in us. Help us to shine your light wherever we go every day. Help us to be who you called us to be for your glory and your honor. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. If you were here last week, you heard our associate pastor, Chuck Miller, talk about superheroes. Chuck knows way more about superheroes than any grown man should. But he is not the only pastor who knows about superheroes. In fact, one of my very favorite stories is from Dr. Charles Lowry, and it's about superheroes. A dad was getting ready for work. He had a trip to make. I don't know what the deal was, but he was doing what we do sometimes. He was in a real hurry, and his little boy came into his room with a very important question. His dad wasn't really interested, but the boy persisted. He said, "Dad, who would you rather be, Batman or Superman?" And his dad is just flustered. He doesn't want to talk about superheroes. He's got to catch his plane or whatever, and he's just trying to get ready. And finally, he just, you know, he persists, and finally the dad just goes, "Oh, I don't know, I guess Superman." And then the little boy goes, "Well, why? Why would you rather be Superman than Batman?" And again, the dad is like a lot of dads and a lot of moms and a lot of us. He's almost too busy to pay any attention. And he's really wanting to leave, and finally he says, "Oh, I guess because he can fly." And then as he's really trying to get it all wrapped up to leave, the little boy goes, "Well, Dad, don't you want to know who I'd rather be?" And the dad just kind of stopped. He says, okay, who would you rather be?" He said, "I'd rather be Batman." And as the dad heard him, he's like, "Okay, great, this is over." And he's just about to walk out of the room, and the little boy says, "Daddy, don't you want to know why I'd rather be Batman than Superman?" And at this point, the dad is just completely, he feels like this is just the end. You know, he's going to miss whatever he's trying to get to. And he goes, "Okay, why would you rather be Batman than Superman?" And the little boy said, "Because Batman had a friend." You have a friend? You have a friend like Batman has a friend? I hope you do. If you have a friend, you're a very blessed person. Walter Winchell was a gossip columnist way back in the 20th century. Any of you remember the 20th century? Way back then. And he made a statement one time. He said this: "A true friend is one who walks in when the rest of the world walks out. A true friend is one who walks in when the rest of the world walks out." You have a friend like that? Proverbs 18:24 talks about a friend who is closer than a brother. I've heard people preach on that and say that that's a reference to Jesus. Well, it might be. Maybe a secondary reference. I really think that there's an emphasis there in Proverbs by Solomon that there is that kind of friend. And maybe you have a friend like that. Maybe you are a friend to someone like that. Friendships are important. Relationships are important. I've mentioned many times the quote from Dr. Foy Valentine. I put it in the reminder this week. The kingdom of God is a kingdom of right relationships. And I've mentioned before, the first time I read that, I missed the word right. I just quoted it several times. The kingdom of God is a kingdom of relationships. But it's not just any relationship. It's a right relationship. And that's what God's after in my life and in yours. And the Apostle Paul understood this well. In his epistles, he mentioned names of people over and over again. We're going to look at the little epistle to Philemon, which only has 25 verses in it. That's why if we put it up here, the basis of love is the title. The text is Philemon 7 through 12. There aren't any chapters in Philemon. You could put chapter 1 if you wanted, but there's no chapter 2, so you don't need to put chapter 1. It's verses 7 through 12. And in that 25-verse epistle, the Apostle Paul mentions 10 people by name. Also, he mentions brothers and fathers and sons and mothers and daughters and husbands and wives and sisters and colleagues and friends. Relationships. But there's a problem, isn't there? Relationships can be hard. They can be. They can be hard. They can be really hard. Relationships can be heartbreaking. They can be messy. That's just life. Shirley O'Neubel wrote a little book called Enjoy, and in that book she quotes a pastor who said, yeah, relationships can be messy, but they're a mess worth making. Relationships are a mess worth making. In our broken world that we've just sung about, right now, in this broken world, we're going to look at this epistle to Philemon. And you might say, Pastor, Philemon? That's just such an insignificant little book. You've already mentioned how short it is. 335 words in the original Greek, 25 verses, no chapters, just the one little bit, that's all? We're going to look at Philemon? Yeah, we're going to look at Philemon. And probably for another couple weeks. In reading about Philemon, I read one commentator who said this, Philemon might have, and this was before all this stuff happened. This was written probably a few months ago. He said this, Philemon might actually be the perfect message for a moment in history consumed with questions of identity and self-realization, social justice, the assertion of rights, and mercy. And more importantly, Philemon represents an opportunity for us to apply the gospel to all these difficult issues. And that's what this is about. Well, the essence of the story is that Philemon had a slave named Onesimus who apparently had run away. And we're going to talk about slavery some. We have to. I'm not going to go really in depth into it. But this is the life of the Roman world. Perhaps as many as two-thirds of the people that Paul came in contact with were slaves. And slaves had roles in the church. And we'll talk about that as we go forward. But for whatever reason, Onesimus left and ran away from his master owner, Philemon, who, by the way, was a leader in the church. In fact, Paul references in verse 2 of Philemon that the church met in Philemon's house. Kind of like y'all have been having church at your house for the last 2 or 3 months, right? Kind of like that. But the bottom line is this, we need to ask ourselves the question, what applications do we need to make from this powerful yet little epistle? I'm going to read verses 7 through 12. Let's consider on the basis of love. Paul writing to Philemon, but the real key character here is probably Onesimus. Onesimus would, I guess, be considered the object of this epistle. Because the issue is, how is Philemon going to respond to Onesimus, who Paul is sending back to him, who was a slave? Paul says, I have come, verse 7, to much joy and comfort in your love, Philemon, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, brother. Therefore, though I have enough confidence in Christ to order you to do what is proper, yet for love's sake, I rather appeal to you, since I am such a person as Paul, the aged, and now also a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I appeal to you for my child Onesimus, whom I have begotten in my imprisonment, who formerly was useless to you, but now is useful both to you and to me. I have sent him back to you in person, that is, sending my very heart. I want to talk about, for the sake of love, for love's sake, that we see in this epistle for just a few moments. I want to talk first of all about the oxygen of love. Look at verse 7. Verse 7, Paul says, I have come to have much joy and comfort in your love. He's speaking to Philemon. I've come to have much joy and comfort in your love because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, brother. John Maxwell, in one of his books many years ago, I read this. He had a doctor friend who said that encouragement was like oxygen for the human soul. Encouragement was like oxygen for the soul. And that's what Paul is saying here. I just think about how love does this. Love brings encouragement. Encouragement brings comfort. It brings the ability to breathe, to just be able to breathe in the air of life and recognize that we have a God who loves us, and he loves us through others, and he blesses and encourages us through others. Mark Twain once said, I can live for at least a month on one good compliment. I can live for at least a month on one good compliment, and I appreciate that. Every now and then I even get a compliment, and I'm not fishing for compliments. Don't give me one today. I don't deserve one, but yeah, those are great. But you know, a lot of people never get those. How many people never get a compliment? How many people never get any encouragement from anyone? We don't know the answer to that, do we? The actress Celeste Holmes said this, "We live by encouragement and we die without it. Slowly, sadly, angrily." Paul commended Philemon for being one who brought much joy and comfort. Another translation says, great joy and much encouragement. And here's the question, who does that for you? Who encourages you? And maybe more importantly, who do you encourage? Who do you comfort? Who do you bless by the way that you live and the things that you do and say? Well, Paul goes on. He says, the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, brother. They've been cheered, one translation says. And that's what encouragers do. They refresh us. Do you ever need any refreshment? Does your life ever get stale? Yeah, sure it does. Everybody's does. It does. And we need refreshment from time to time. My best example ever of this, how many of you went to Peru at some point or time? You went with us to Peru. Raise your hand. Raise them up high. I want to see those hands. Okay, Mike West, I see your hand. Mike and I, the first trip I went on, Mike and I slept one the first night. That was it. Mike said no more. He brought a tent. I brought nothing. I was the least prepared missionary in the history of missions, and I slept with Mike West. Just imagine, I mean, Mike's not that big, but I'm a pretty big guy, and here the two of us are in a one-man tent, and I had that little battery-operated fan. You remember that fan that Glenn Padgett told me to buy? It was ridiculous. So, anyway, that just gives an example. That week, we spent in the jungle, first time I'd ever been in the jungle. And we spent a week in the jungle, and we got on the boat to come back up the river, and it took however many hours, and the bridge was out. I don't remember. There was flooding. We had to actually walk across a log to get back home. Anyway, I almost died. You almost lost your pastor and several other very important people. But we got back, and we got to this little port there on the river. It's called Puerto Copa. And David Welburn and one of our translators, Mihael, whose father named all his children after communist leaders, Mihael and David Welburn and I went in this little shanty bar in the hot sun afternoon because I knew they would have a cold Coca-Cola. And I went in there and I bought a Coca-Cola for David Welburn and for myself and for Mihael, and the three of us drank our Coca-Colas in about 20 seconds because we'd been in the jungle for a week. We hadn't had anything cold or refreshing at all for a week. And that's probably the most refreshing thing I'd ever tasted in my life. Now, I know Coca-Cola's bad for you, so, you know, I know we're not supposed to drink bad stuff, but because of the sugar and all that. But for that day, man, it just blessed my soul, not just my body. Well, that's what I think of when I think of refreshing. And I think some of us are missing that. And one of the reasons we're missing it is because we don't repent. We don't repent. In Acts chapter 3, Peter says, he's preaching, he says, repent and return so that your sins may be wiped away in order that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. I went to a meeting Thursday, about 60 or 70 Christian leaders from the area, and it's a racial roundtable, pastor's racial roundtable group. I don't get to go to their meetings very much because they meet on Wednesday mornings. That's my busiest morning normally, and I haven't been to a meeting in a while. But in light of all that's going on, I really believed I needed to be here. And the only problem is I told Randy earlier, he said, how was the meeting? I said, well, you had one microphone and 60 or 70 preachers. That's a recipe for disaster. And Michelle wasn't even there. So, you know, just a recipe for disaster. And I told Ryan, I said, I'm not saying anything unless the Holy Spirit just jerks me up physically and thrusts me forward, which he didn't. But a lot of people may not have had that same commitment going in. But the one, and everybody said good things, but the one guy that really touched me, I don't even know this brother. I don't know who he is. But he just got up in front of all those pastors and Christian leaders, and he said this. He said, the word that's on my heart is repent. And he said, now I'm not talking about you repenting. And I'm not talking about them repenting. I'm talking about me repenting for my sin, for my biases, for my prejudices, for my attitudes. And I'll just tell you this. If we did that as believers, if we would just examine our own hearts, don't have to make a show about it, just examine our hearts and be honest with God. You know, we don't see all this. There's a very, and you all, I've heard, you've heard me say, we have blind spots. And here's the thing about blind spots. I have them and you have them. And you say, well, so do those people. Yeah, everybody has them. And here's the thing about blind spots. You can't see them. That's why they're called blind spots. And one of the greatest prayers in the whole Bible is in Psalm 19, when David prays and he says, verses 13 and 14, he says, who can discern his errors? Acquit me of hidden faults. Also keep your servant back from presumptuous sins. Let them not rule over me. I want to tell you, folks, that is a great, if you want to memorize a couple verses, that's a great, everybody's memorized the next verse. The next verse says, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. But those verses that precede it say, God, I've got hidden sins in my heart. I don't see them. Please forgive me for those things. Don't let those things cause me to lose my witness. That's the thing I'm thinking about. We're going to talk about that in a minute. The bottom line is this. The oxygen of love is to encourage and comfort and bless others. I'll give you this real quick. My men's group's reading a book by Max Lucado, of course, and he quoted a guy by the name of Mark Rutland, who I don't know who he is, but they did a survey to find out what are the three-word phrases that people want to hear the most? Well, all right, Zach, here's a new staff member. He doesn't know how the preacher does he? Zach, what is the first three-word phrase that most people want to hear? The number one three-word phrase. Zach's been to college. He's in seminary. He's been here for a month now. He should have learned something. So here we go. The number one three-word phrase that people most want to hear. What is it? He got it. Let's give him a hand. I love you. That's right. Oh, I'm so encouraged. Zach got that right. All right, that's the first. You know what the second phrase that people want to hear? I forgive you. You know what the third phrase is? Supper is ready. Listen, I'm not surprised by any of those things. That's what, I do. I want to hear somebody say, I love you. I want to hear somebody say, I forgive you. And I want to hear somebody say, supper is ready, lunch is ready, whatever. But Max Lucado translates it this way. He says, those are the three phrases that summarize the message of Jesus. He came with love. He came with grace, and he came with a dinner invitation. Read Revelation 3:20. That's what he came with. That's what he comes with. Have you received that? Well, the oxygen of love is encouragement and refreshment that it brings to others. Finally, the demand of love is the rest of the passage. Verses 8 through 12. I'm going to just skip to verse 9. Well, verses 8 and 9, he says, therefore, though I have enough confidence in Christ to order you to do what is proper, in other words, one translation put, I could order you to do what you should do. Because, by the way, I am the Apostle Paul. You get that? He talks about being Paul the aged. Well, I'm Tim the aged, and as your pastor, I could order you to do this, but that's not what I'm going to do, and that's not what Paul did. In verse 9, he says, instead, for love's sake, I rather appeal to you. I appeal to you to do what's right. Paul wrote to the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 5:14, for the love of Christ controls us. I want to just ask you a question. Is that true in your life? Is the love of Christ controlling you? Does it control the things you think? Does it control the things you say? Does it control the things you do? That's a big question. It's a hard question. It doesn't always. The love of Christ is supposed to control me always, but if I'm honest, it doesn't. It just should. Paul says, I have confidence to order you to do it, but rather for love's sake, I appeal to you. I appeal to you, as one translation puts it, on the basis of the love that he just spoke about in verse 7. You remember, I never knew until I came to Roebuck Baptist Church. We had a Maundy Thursday service. I never knew what Maundy meant. I just thought it was a word that meant, yes, yeah, that's the night before Good Friday when it gets dark and you recognize the death of Jesus. I'd been to seminary. I had a doctor's degree. Nobody ever told me what it meant. It sounds like a morbid word. So I just thought it means, oh, that's a bad night, you know, Maundy Thursday. It comes from the Latin for commandment. You see the M-A-N-D in commandment? And so what that references, that Maundy Thursday is commandment Thursday. What's the commandment? When Jesus got the disciples all together, he said, a new commandment do I give to you, that you love one another. Now stop just a minute. That's not a new commandment. That's in the Old Testament. The Old Testament is filled with that commandment. It's all over the Bible. So how would Jesus say that's a new commandment? Because of what he said next. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you. That's what was new. Because the next day, Jesus was going to die on the cross for the sins of those disciples and the sins of everybody else who's ever lived. And he's saying to them, I want you to love one another, but not just normal love. I want you to love the way I have loved you. And then he says this. He says, by this. By what? By this love. Not by our power, not by our money, not by our education, not by our politics, not by anything else. By our love for one another will all men know that you're my disciples. That's how the world's going to know that we're his disciples, if we love one another. If they see us loving one another the way Jesus loves us. And Francis Schaeffer wrote in his book, The Mark of a Christian, he said, in the midst of our present dying culture, Jesus is giving a right to the world. Upon his authority, Jesus gives the world the right to judge whether you and I are born again Christians on the basis of our observable love toward all Christians. Now, he goes on to say, Jesus isn't saying that the world has the right to determine whether or not we're saved. That's not what he's saying. What he's saying is they have the right to determine whether they think we're saved based on what they see. And when the world sees Christians acting like non-Christians and not loving one another and not loving others, that's a terrible witness. And that's why when I look at all the stuff that's going on in our world, there are a million answers. I'm not sure any of them really answers, but there are a million people with answers. I look at it as a discipleship issue in the church. We haven't made disciples. We've made a lot of commitments, made a lot of decisions. But we need to make disciples who are going to make disciples, who are going to make other disciples. That's Jesus' plan. And when people are disciples, they're going to love one another the way Jesus loved them. And the world's going to see that, and the world's going to be drawn to that. But when the church doesn't do that, the world is rebuffed. The world says, I don't want any part of that. When the world sees hypocrisy, when the world sees pettiness, when the world sees the kind of things that the church is all, listen, I've told y'all many times, I am a firm believer that if a person objectively studies church history, the person who objectively does that is going to come to the conclusion that Jesus Christ, he may not give his life to Jesus, but he or she's going to come to the conclusion that Jesus Christ truly is the Savior and Lord of the universe. But that doesn't mean the church doesn't have scars. The church doesn't have skeletons in its closet. By the way, they aren't in the closet. They're out of the closet. So what Paul is saying here is this. Philemon, Onesimus is your slave. I'm sending him back to you as your brother in Christ. By the way, the word Onesimus means useful. And in the last verse there, he says, verse 11, formerly he was useless to you, but now he's useful both to you and to me. And here's the thing, as Christians, nobody should be more useful than us. I got to tell this story. When I was in youth ministry many years ago, I had a guy in my college group who was a sweet, sweet Christian brother. I loved him so much. His name was Greg Lehman. I don't know where Greg is today, but I've told this story before. Greg became a Christian the summer between his junior and senior year in high school. And God really got a hold of Greg. It changed his life, which is what it's supposed to do. Sometimes it doesn't seem to. And so Greg was graduating from Florida Southern College with a degree in citrus. Can't get that at Wofford, but he got that at Florida Southern College in Central Florida. And he was getting interviewed for these jobs, and these people were looking at his permanent record. And they noticed that Greg was a C student all through school. You know why he's a C student? Because he was lazy. He didn't work hard. He didn't try. He just tried to get by. I'm sure none of y'all ever did that, but he did. And then his senior year, he made straight A's. And the people that were interviewing said, what in the world took, what happened? He said, oh, that's easy. I became a Christian. Between my junior and senior year in high school, I became a Christian, and I started applying myself, and I became a good student by the grace of God. Listen, that ought to be our testimony. Jesus ought to make that difference. Paul said in Colossians 3:23, whatever you do, do your work heartily as unto the Lord rather than to men, knowing he's the Lord Christ whom you serve. When you go to work, it's the Lord Christ whom you serve. When you go to school, go to class, it's the Lord Christ whom you serve. When you relate to your wife, your husband, your kids, your grandkids, it's the Lord Christ whom you serve. When you interact with your neighbors who may be Democrats or maybe another color or maybe something other than you are, it's the Lord Christ whom you serve. That's it. That's the demand of love. Well, wrapping up, my default verse on relationships is always Romans 5:1. In Romans 5:1, Paul says this, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. The only relationship that's going to get us to the place where we need to get is that one. We start there. You cannot be justified. I put this on social media last week. The guy who came to Jesus said, what's the greatest commandment? And Jesus told him, love the Lord your God, etc. Love your neighbors yourself. And then this guy who was a lawyer, it says he's trying to justify himself. That's what we do all the time. We keep trying to justify ourselves. You can't do it. That's foolish. I do it all the time. I'm not going to ever, pray for me that I would never do it again. I don't want to try to justify myself because I can't. Having been justified by faith, we can have peace with God. You have peace with God this morning? If you don't, you need to find it through Jesus Christ. That's what the verse says. And then your relationships can grow. Then you can love your neighbor as yourself. Then you can love your brother as Christ loved you. You can love your enemy. In fact, the Bible doesn't give us an out. There's nobody we're not supposed to love. First of all, he says we're supposed to love all men. All men. Everybody. It comes down to relationships. Now, real quick, I'm going to close with this, and then we're going to sing and have our time of invitation. Here's the thing. You guys remember the black and white, the black and white Perry Mason TV shows. How many of you remember the black and white Perry Mason TV shows? Okay, everybody over 80 raised their hand just now. Okay, that's good. All right, those shows were great. Here's why they were great. And I didn't like the newer ones, but, you know, that's fine. But those were great because in every case, somebody got murdered in every Perry Mason episode that I ever saw. And Perry Mason always was the defense attorney for the person who was accused of the murder. But he never had a guilty client. Maybe one time he did, I don't remember. But typically, he never had a guilty client. But in the course of the trial, Perry Mason would figure out exactly what happened. And there would be somebody who would have been a witness or whatever who had actually done the murder. And Perry Mason, without saying, Zach did it, he would, this is the way I put it, I'm borrowing this. He would cut off the legs of any possible alibi for this person. And it would get to the point, if you ever watch him, there was a confession in the courtroom every time. It never happens like that, but that's the way it was on every Perry Mason show. All of a sudden, the guy who did it or the woman who did it would say, I did it, I hated him, I did it, I did it. Because Perry Mason would just cut the legs out of any possible alibi. Well, that's what the New Testament does to slavery. And by the way, Philemon has been used to defend slavery. We'll talk about that more in the future. I'm reading a book right now by Rebecca McLaughlin. It's called Confronting Christianity. It was the book of the year from Christianity Today, and she's got a chapter about slavery. And this is what she says. The New Testament argues against slavery by cutting the legs out from it. With no room for superiority, that's what racism is. With no room for exploitation, that's what sex trafficking is. With no room for coercion, but rather brotherhood and shared identity, the New Testament created a building tension that would ultimately erupt in the abolition of slavery. That's because God cares about people. And when Paul sent Onesimus back to Philemon, he said, whether he goes back as a slave or not, here's the first thing you need to recognize. He's your brother in Christ. He's your brother in Christ. And that's how you need to treat him. The kingdom of God is a kingdom of right relationships. It starts with our relationship with him, and it extends to our spouses, our kids, our grandkids, our brothers, our sisters, neighbors, enemies, everybody. That's where it goes. That's where those relationships go. The kingdom of God is a kingdom of right relationships. How are yours? How are mine? That's the question. Let's pray. Father, thank you today for this great story, this little book of Philemon, and the powerful truth that is in here that reminds us and shows us that it's about relationships. It starts with our relationship with you. And I pray today, I know most of the people who are here today, if not all of them, but I pray that if there's anybody here this morning who has never made a personal commitment to Jesus, I pray that he or she would do that today. And like my buddy Greg Lehman, that he or she would see the difference that Jesus makes. As 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if anyone is in Christ, he or she is a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, new things have come. Father, that's what we need to see. That's what the world needs to see. So this week, help us not to complain. Help us not to look for opportunities to be critical. Help us to pray and help us to live and help us to let your light shine through us that those around us might see Jesus, that they might come to embrace Jesus as Lord and Savior, that you might be glorified because every relationship, the goal of every relationship that you've given is for your glory, for your glory. Help us to understand that. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to have our time of invitation. We're going to do whatever you want to do. I'm going to ask you to stand. They're going to sing. I'm going to be here at the front. If you need to come for any reason at all, if you need to come for prayer, if you need to come and give your life to Christ, if you need to come, just whatever you need to do, pray by yourself, pray with one of us, whatever the deal, that's what we're going to do for just a couple minutes. Let's stand together. You come as we sing.
Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he is my song. You are good, good.
the group next week is meeting at 10 o'clock, parents, and that's going to be in the fellowship hall, Michelle. I wanted to make sure Zach thought it was, so that's good. Also, some of you have asked about when are we going to start doing other things. We're praying about all that, working through all of that. But you can meet, your classes or groups can meet right now if you will schedule with us when you'd like to meet. We have to do all that. We've assigned a number for every room that we have in our education area. So if you've got a group of, 15 or less or something, we can accommodate you. Yes. That's what, 25? 23, okay. My scripture passages for y'all to read. So if you want to schedule your group, feel free. Call the church office. Michelle Sontag will get your information. We do that to schedule so there won't be conflicts and also to make sure the rooms are properly cleaned. And so those are the things that we're looking at right now. And we're still continuing to pray and monitor the situation regarding what it's safe to do. And so you'll be hearing more about this in the days ahead. Now, Chuck is not here today, but he wanted me to make sure that you remember if you're in D groups, this is a requirement. If you don't do this, then you get excommunicated. You have to read 1 Samuel chapters 20 through 23 this week. If you're not in a D group, we encourage you to do that as well. And by the way, some of you asked about our literature. Open Windows, Home Life, and Mature Living will be available beginning tomorrow for this quarter. You need to come by the church to get your copy. If you can't come by, call us and we'll mail you one, okay? But we don't have them available today. All right, I think that's it. So at this time, we're going to ask the ushers to begin the process of exiting us out from the back to the front. Thank you so much for being here this morning. God bless you.